that work? All right, we'll make it work. Okay, because of time purposes here, we'll have to go quickly through my travel pictures. So this is the main cathedral in Florence. Beautiful architecture. This is the dome inside the cathedral. It's got you know, medieval paintings on the top. I don't remember who did this. Michelangelo did not, so I'm not sure who did this, but you know, very famous paintings. And if you go way to the top, you can climb inside the outer shell and pop out up above there and look around at Florence. And so here's a close-up. And it's basically biblical things. There's people being burned in hell, and there's people going to heaven. It's very interesting. You can spend an hour just looking at the various murals here on the inside of the dome. And this is, as you go up inside, between the outer wall and the inner wall where the dome is, these are old popes that are sitting there inside. These are statues of old popes. Okay, and then the higher up you get, the closer you get to the dome. All right, cornea. Let's go ahead and we'll just start. We'll just zigzag our, now let's go this way. Zigzag, will someone please do it? All right, let's go over layers of the cornea.
All right, so starting it anteriorly, we have the corneal epithelium. Underlying that is the epithelial basement membrane and then Bowman's. And then there's the corneal stroma and then decimase membrane and layer of endothelium.
Excellent. All right, let's talk about the corneal epithelium. What's the epithelium of the cornea like?
It's a stratified squamous.
Okay. How many layers thick usually?
5 to 7.
5 to 7, exactly. Now, I'm going to ask you one more question. What kind of stain is this and why am I showing it?
That looks like a PAS stain.
What is PAS stain for?
It stains, I think, basement membranes.
Exactly. So why would I show you this picture?
Well, it looks like it's highlighting the basement membrane of the epithelium.
And what is not staining here?
That looks like Bowman's layer.
Exactly. So it's very important that you remember Bowman's layer is not a basement membrane. So the basement membrane of the epithelium is this thin little line right up here. And so Bowman's layer does not regenerate. So if you're looking at a pathology specimen and there is no Bowman's layer there, it's a historical record that something happened to Bowman's layer. And so Bowman's layer does not regenerate. It's a condensed part of anterior stroma. Now, tell me a little bit about the stroma. What lives in the stroma?
So the stroma itself is made up of collagen fibrils, also keratinocytes. It's dehydrated, so it could be clear, so you can see through it.
And the thing about the corneal stroma is the fibers are all regular. Mm-hmm. So there's a regular array of these collagen fibers, and they run limbus to limbus. So if you cut them, even if the cornea heals, it still does not have the strength that it had before they were cut. Now, some of the differences between cornea and sclera, why cornea is clear and sclera isn't, the fibers in the cornea all line up exactly the same. So if it's detrogested, it allows light to come through, whereas in the sclera, they're at random angles. And the sclera is not detrogested. That's why the sclera is white, the cornea is clear. What layer are we looking at right here? All right, now tell me a little bit about decimase membrane. What forms decimase membrane?
Decimase membrane is
they're
tightly packed together, like tight junctions,
so that water can't. Okay, that's the endothelial cells. Where
does decimase membrane come from? Decimase membrane.
So decimase membrane is actually the basement membrane of the endothelial cell. So it is PAS positive. That's important because Bowman's is not. Now, if you did an EM of decimase membrane, the anterior layer of decimase is what we call banded. And so the collagen fibers are banded, whereas the posterior is non-banded. And so the anterior part of decimase comes congenitally, whereas the posterior part gets thicker with age because it is the basement membrane of the endothelial cell. Right. What are these right here?
Those are the endothelial cells themselves.
Now, that's something, take a look at that picture. You never see these in the path lab because the endothelial cells are rarely healthy when you do a cornea specimen. And so this is what a healthy endothelium looks like. Now, tell me one of the functions of the endothelium.
It has barrier function.
Okay, and what is it about it that forms that barrier? It's been said, but say it again.
Yeah, it goes to like the zonule occludens, like this kind of zonular kind of junctions that go around the endothelial cells.
Exactly. So when you look at these endothelial cells, they are cuboidal when you look at them in cross section, but if you look at them in 3D, they're hexagonal and they're shaped like a geodesic dome. That's how nature covers a curved surface. And so they have tight junctions between them, which acts as a barrier to keep the fluid from the anterior chamber going into the cornea, to heat your gestures of the cornea. What else does endothelium do?
It dehydrates the stroma.
Okay, so it does that usually by the barrier. What else does it do that helps it stay dehydrated?
Pumping fluid.
Yeah, there's actually some pumping capabilities to that, both directions. So that'll lead us to what else? What else is going on here, man? What else does it do?
It can transport nutrients.
Yeah, so it'll actually pump nutrients from the anterior chamber into the cornea itself. So there is a function there where it'll actually pump nutrients in. All right, let's talk about some corneal diseases. What are we looking at right here?
It's like man cave.
All right. So what is it that forms band keratopathy?
Calcium.
All right. Now here's a close-up. Now it's interesting. What am I showing here on this close-up? Why would I be showing this? What are these little round spaces here?
There's like little cystic spaces there.
They are actually where the nerves penetrate through the stroma of the cornea up through Bowman's layer. And so in the area where the little nerve penetrates, you don't get calcium deposited, so you get these little lacunar spaces. So that just kind of shows you where the nerves come up through Bowman's layer to the epithelium. And you said it, this is caused by
calcium.
Deposition of calcium. So what kind of stain for bonus points do we use for calcium?
Alizarin red.
Okay, so you can use two of them. One is alizarin red, the other is von Tassin. So those are the two. And so this is the red one. And here's epithelium. Here is Bowman's layer. And here's all that calcium. So that's band keratopathy. We'll just swing over. Is that John?
Yep.
John, I'm showing this picture, and here's all this calcium. Here's Bowman's layer. What is this stuff? All right, so what's it called when you have fibrous connective tissue in between the epithelium and Bowman's layer coming out from the limbus? Pannus. And so this is a pannus. Now, how do we subcharacterize pannicisms? Panni. I don't know. What is plural for pannus?
Panni. So, would its radium be one kind of?
No, because that's on the surface. So what kind of pannus? What makes up this pannus?
Fibrous tissue.
This is a fibrous pannus. And then we look at this. This is a fibrovascular. So here's Bowman's, here's the epithelium. Here are all kinds of vessels along with the connective tissue. So you can get a fibrous pannus. You can get a fibrovascular pannus, and it all extends from the limbus under the epithelium on the surface of Bowman's from chronic inflammation. And as we showed earlier, chronic inflammation also causes band keratopathy, so you can get the two of them, running together. Here's epithelium, fibrous pannus, calcium along Bowman's, and calcium here. So you can get a pannus and you can get band keratopathy running together in the same patient. All right, what are we showing right here? All right, so what does that, what is that called, first of all? Yes, well, senilis, people don't like that word anymore, so it's an aging change, but it's in the literature, it's arcus senilis. What is the material that forms an arcus sinuatus?
Lipid.
And if you look, whenever you see a clear space between the limbus and the deposits, that's a sign that diffusion is what causes it. So it's diffusion of lipid. And what kind of stain do we have to do to stain lipid?
Oil red.
Oil red on. What do we have to do to that specimen to get the stain?
Keep it fresh.
Exactly. So this is a freshly frozen one. It's interesting, if you look at it, the deposition of the lipid is hourglass shaped, meaning there's more of an anteriorly, there's more of a posteriorly, and it thins out in the center. So if you hallucinate, you know, pathologists are good at hallucinating because we spend a lot of time sniffing formalin. So it affects our brain cells. And so you can see there's anterior deposition, posterior deposition, it thins out in the middle, kind of an hourglass shape. So that is arcus sinuatus. Now, it used to be taught in the olden days when I was a resident that this was a sign of high cholesterol, that you had to work up a patient for high cholesterol. It turns out, yes, high cholesterol could do this, but it's not necessarily that it's high cholesterol associated with this all the time. It's just occurred in normal aging. Sir?
For unilateral arcus, do you guys still consider like carotid occlusive disease?
Yeah, you need to work that up because this is by definition a bilateral disease. So something, if it's unilateral, something is going on to the supply of nutrients to that eye. All right, what are we seeing back here? Who came in here? Is that Dan?
Tim.
Yeah. All right. What kind of material have we put in? What stain did we put in here to take this picture? Fluorescein. So this is a fluorescein stain, and you can see that fluorescein stains areas of denuded epithelium. So when you look right here, you see that this is denuded in the center. It's got these little bulbs. So if you're going to scrape that for a culture, where would you scrape it? Right. So not in the middle where that's denuded, but in the edges where you still have viral fibers that are going on. So you said herpes. Which one? Which one? Uh-huh. Yeah, most likely one. Now, there have been reported cases of two, but usually it's herpes simplex 1, which is the one that, same thing that gives you a cold sore. So herpes simplex 1 is usually it. And then we look at the pathology. What are we seeing on the pathology here? You get a few scattered mononuclear lymphocytes in here. So, yes, sir.
You just scrape the edges. You're talking about the terminal bulbs.
Well, yeah, you can do it so long as you've got partially next to where the stain is going on. You don't want to take it right in the middle where they're staining because there it's all denuded and you may not pick up anything. All right, so that's what a normal epithelial herpes dendrite looks like. What is different right here? Believe it or not, this is a patient with herpes.
I think the stroma looks a little more intact here, but there is still what looks like a little break in the epithelium.
A little break there, but what's going on down here?
It's a lot of disorganization in the posterior cornea, and I don't really see a clear decimase.
So you're seeing a lot of inflammatory cells here. So this has now gone from simply epithelial herpes to what we call stromal herpes. And in fact, if you look closer, sometimes you'll even get giant cells along decimase membrane. So this is actually posterior. So this is inflammation posterior in the anterior chamber here. And these are giant cells along decimase membrane. So when you get stromal deep herpes, sometimes that can be even thought of as an autoimmune disease. Something changes the herpes change the antigens on there. And even when there's not active disease going on, you can still get ongoing inflammation in the stroma. So stromal herpes. And this is actually a scraping before we had, you know, good immunoperoxidase stains and good assays for herpes. And you can see inclusions here, both in the nucleus and also a little in the cytoplasm, but a lot of these intranuclear inclusions here with herpes. All right, what are we seeing here?
Well, it looks like there's a lot of inflammation
spotted conjunctival kinosis, maybe what could be like a subconscious hemorrhage, some opacification of the cornea as well, some kind of discontinuity where it looks like maybe the surface of the cornea is.
Okay, if this were infectious, would this be viral or bacterial looking at this?
I mean, I guess it's a little hard to tell because I usually, you know, tend to look for discharge, but I would guess, you know, just take a guess, bacterial.
Yeah, and there, believe it or not, there's a little bit of discharge down here. So this is a bacterial ulcer. If you see a bacterial ulcer that's this extensive, you really got to jump on it right away because that's a sign of a pretty aggressive bacteria. This turned out to be a Pseudomonas from this patient's contact lens. And so this is a Pseudomonas ulcer. And the thing about these ulcers is it is really an ophthalmic emergency because these can perforate a cornea in 24 to 48 hours if it's an active bacteria, because the bacteria itself can put out collagenases and proteinases, but so do the body's immune system. So the body sends in these PMNs, they dump out all the material that's in their granules, which can melt corneas also. So this is truly an ophthalmic emergency. And what happened to this cornea?
It looks like the whole kind of anterior half of it is basically gone.
Okay, so there's a big ulcer here. What is this?
That looks like it's probably a full thickness perforation.
Exactly. So this actually perforated. And if you look right here, you see that's white, that's pale, that's necrotic. It's not the normal pink, you know, colors of the stroma and the cornea. And here you see all these inflammatory cells. And when we look closely, as opposed to herpes, this is more of an acute inflammation. So this has PMNs in it, but also lymphocytes, but PMN, so this is an acute inflammatory cell reaction. And unfortunately, if you don't treat these right away, you can get this. And so what's happened here? That's all right, well, you've been good enough. What's happened here?
So this also seems like some sort of perforation of the actual stroma.
Okay, what is this thing?
Is that like the curling of decimase?
Does decimase have pigment?
Oh, so it's uveal tissue?
Okay, what kind of uveal tissue?
Like pars
bottom. So we're just pulling, we're yanking, pulling, pulling. Now, what lives behind the cornea?
Iris.
Iris.
Yeah.
All right, and so believe it or not, here's ciliary body, here's iris. That's iris. And so when you get a perforation, the iris can go right up in there and try to plug it up. So this is a perforated corneal ulcer with iris plugging it. And how do we know it's iris? What is unique about the pigment epithelium in the iris compared to the rest of the eye?
Not sure.
Okay. Abby. What's unique about the pigment epithelium in the iris as opposed to the rest of the eye? And by the way, saying you're not sure is good. That's better than just digging deeper. Oh, is it this? Is it that? And when you take oral boards, they'll look at you and they'll go, tell me more. And when you say that, that means, oh my God, I'm getting deeper and deeper. And then you say, I do not know, and move on. So what's different about the pigment epithelium of the iris compared to pigment epithelium, say, of the ciliary body and elsewhere? Both layers of the iris pigment epithelium are pigmented, whereas in the ciliary body, only the outer layer is pigmented, the inner layer is non-pigmented. So that's how you know it's iris. You have pigment epithelium, both of them pigmented. All right, what are we looking at right here? Jordan?
Also pretty red, flame, external photo. I would do as well as like stuff, I would also be concerned about like a bacterial ulcer.
So what if I told you this is a potato farmer from Idaho? This has been going on for 3 or 4 weeks. Now it's the fall. They just did the harvest.
Think about other like fungal keratitis.
All right. So the word we use is indolent. And so instead of an acute presentation. It's indolent. It smolders for several weeks, and then, you know, stubborn old rancher farmer, you know, they're not going to come in until the eye is coming out of their head. And so finally they come in. You see this. I want you to look. Not only is there this lesion here where it's white, but look at that fluffy white halo around it. And this is the stain that we did. What does this show?
So this shows what one looks like.
excuse me.
Just fungi.
All right. And what kind of stain do we do for fungi?
GMS.
Gomori methenamine silver. And so it stains fungi a silvery black color. So if you look right here, you'll see all these little yeasty beasties in here throughout the stroma. So that's a fungal ulcer, a little bit more indolent than a bacterial, but harder to treat. Because, you know, fungi don't react real well to the antifungals, which are pretty toxic to the eye in any event. What are we seeing right here?
So this is an external photograph. The cornea looks pretty diffusely hazy. Concentrated centrally, there's said to be a ring infiltrate, and then the epithelium looks to be denuded with kind of a rolled margin.
Okay. What gives you a chronic epithelial denuded and a ring-shaped infiltrate?
This person was having a lot of pain. I think he can't be, but if they were abusing topical steroids, topical proparacaine.
Exactly. Now, topical anesthetic use can give you a chronic non-healing ulcer, but it usually doesn't give you that ring infiltrate. So you said acanthamoeba. What stain is this?
Green.
All right. So we remember Gridley because it stains the cornea stroma green. And sure enough, here are the cysts of acanthamoeba all throughout the cornea. So we do a Gridley stain. You can actually see these on H&E stain. They don't pick up the stain, but you can see the outline of the little cyst even on an H&E stain. Now, these are very difficult to treat because you have to get in there, and once they insist, they're a little bit resistant to treatment. So the problem with these is they can get out beyond the cornea, even into the limbus and into the stroma and along the nerves. That's why they're painful. So this is acanthamoeba, but you want to recognize these because if you can treat them early, you can sometimes save a cornea. And it's interesting, we treat them with swimming pool disinfectant. That's basically the drops we use nowadays, are swimming pool disinfectant, which kills the acanthamoeba. And here's an EM showing you this triple walled cyst. And so once they insist, they're pretty resistant to treatment. All right, what are we seeing right here?
External photograph of the red eye, attention drawn to the cornea. Looks pretty interior. You can see some irregularities of most likely the epithelium. I would be concerned for map dot fingerprint.
Okay, let's say we do a slit lamp and it looks like this. Does that help?
Not really.
Actually, if you look at that right there, what does that look like?
It looks like little fingerprints.
It's like a fingerprint,
yeah.
Exactly. So when you have, we call it an epithelial basement membrane dystrophy. It depends on which pattern you get. Map dot fingerprint is literally descriptive. So it'll look like the edges of a map, like this first one, where there's the edges of a map here. It can look like a fingerprint, which is here, or it can look like a dot, which is there. So this is all caused by what?
Basically, like redundant epithelial tissue, and I think
more specific, not redundant epithelial tissue, but redundant epithelial what?
Basement membrane.
Basement membrane, exactly. So this is a basement membrane dystrophy, and if you look, I apologize. I think one of my fellows took this picture. Mine are always in focus. So this was whenever there's something that's out of focus, blame someone below you. So. If you're an intern, sorry, it doesn't go lower than you. All right, so this is actually what stain?
This would be PAS.
PAS stain, and here you see this thickened epithelial basement membrane and you've had recurrent erosions and then the epithelium grows over them. And so the problem with mapped out fingerprint is you can get recurrent corneal erosions. And when you treat that, you often have to scrape off all the epithelium and all the basement membrane and give it a restart to grow. And so this is a scraping we had. Here's the epithelium. Look at all this. This is all thickened basement membrane. So this is actually a map dot fingerprint that was scraped, and that is all markedly thickened basement membrane. And so epithelial basement membrane dystrophy. All right, what are we seeing here?
Those lymphatic have these diffuse little anterior cyst-like deposits.
All right, so these are kind of, you know, once again, below the epithelium, but they're really almost like specific little whitish deposits. What do you think about here?
You think about dystrophy of some sort.
Okay. Here's the pathology. Again, what kind of stain would this be?
So PAS.
PAS. So you see Bowman's is not staining. You've got this PAS positive stuff underneath the epithelium. So this, it's hard because these dystrophies, they all look the same. They're really difficult. This is called Meesmann's dystrophy. And it's interesting, the pathologist who first described this called this peculiar substance. So it's interesting. They weren't quite sure what this stuff was, so they called it peculiar substance. So you get this peculiar PAS positive substance underneath the epithelium, and that is Meesmann's dystrophy. All right, what are we looking at right here? Let's see, Sean.
This is concern. It looks like the entire stroma area is based on slightly opacified.
Believe it or not, that's a weird way it's coming off. So this is mostly anterior again, but it's really diffuse and kind of feathery. And what could look like this?
I mean, so.
So here's the pathology, and what I want you to look at here is the distinct absence diffusely of Bowman's layer and then kind of a condensed stroma underneath it. What dystrophy gives you that? Exactly. And so the buckler's got a whatever, a umlauted above it's Buchler's, so Ries Buchler's dystrophy. And there are various different types of Ries Buchler's dystrophy, so you need to know those for boards and for corneal lectures. But the pathology is really kind of an absence diffusely here of Bowman's layer. So those are kind of the anterior corneal dystrophies that have unique pathology. Now we're going to jump down into the stroma. So Nama, tell me what the mnemonic is that we use to remember corneostromal dystrophies. All right, so Maryland. Macular, Monroe. Mucopolysaccharide, really?
Recessive.
Because that's easy to remember. Now the rest are all dominant. Getz. Really always. All right, always Alshin Blue. So, which one would this be? Yeah, if you even look in between these deposits in the stroma, there's haziness. So, that's macular dystrophy. And then, what kind of stain is this? Alshin Blue, always. So Alshin Blue stains the mucopolysaccharide. So here is Alshin Blue stain, and it'll stain this mucopolysaccharide, this dark blue color here in the stroma. And that's a close-up, again, showing you this granular blue mucopolysaccharide material. Okay. Next one down the mnemonic. Getz. Her. Man, it's on track up. So here you see granular. Now, the way you tell granular from macular is they're these breadcrumb-looking deposits, but it's clear in between. So when you see the deposit, you see that the stroma in between is clear. And here's a retroillumination, multiple deposits here, but clear spaces in between. And then M? The Sans trichrome. So here's a trichrome stain, staining this hyaline material here in the anterior stroma. All right, I guess we come back. L?
Lattice.
A?
Amyloid.
California. C?
Congo red.
So this is lattice dystrophy. These lattice lines that you can see coursing through the stroma. And this is consistent with amyloid. And so this is the amyloid stain, the Congo red. Kind of a misnomer. It's really more of a burnt orange rather than a red. But in any event, this is Congo red. And why would I be showing you this picture? What does amyloid do under the microscope if we treat it in the right way?
Birefringence.
Yes, so it's got birefringence. So if you take you take polarized filters and cross them, you get birefringence. And believe it or not, this is a picture through the scope of all of these little areas of amyloid lighting up. Now, if we suspect amyloid in there, normally when my technician cuts regular histopathologic slides, they're about 3 to 5 microns thick. That's not thick enough to bend the light for the birefringence. So if you're worried about it, whenever we do a stain with the Congo red, I always tell my technician, make it a little bit thicker, more like almost 5 to 10 microns thick. And then when you cross-polarize the filter, you end up getting this cross-polarization. You get the amyloid material lighting up. Now, the other thing you want to remember is amyloid doesn't just occur in lattice. You can also get systemic amyloid or local amyloid affecting the eye. And believe it or not, this is a cornea that underwent a transplant, and this turned out to be amyloid. So here again, we're trying to cross-polarize a little bit. Congo red stain, you can see amyloid everywhere in this cornea. So systemic or local amyloid around the eye can also do this in addition to lattice. All right, what are we seeing right here?
So it's an image of a cornea. Looks like it's pretty diffusely opaque, but kind of there's also kind of some texture to the surface that looks like it could be something similar to like guttata.
All right, so we go ahead and we do a retroillumination. It looks like this.
Yeah, so again, it's like kind of looks like the. I guess I'm not sure which surface that would be based on this.
Believe it or not, this is all posterior.
But again, it looks kind of textured and bumpy, which again would be considered consistent with guttata.
And which entity are guttata seen in?
Fuchs.
Fuchs. So Fuchs endothelial dystrophy. So we're now working our way through the cornea. We've gone from anterior dystrophies to stromal dystrophies, now to posterior. And so this is a patient with Fuchs, and they'll often say this is a beaten metal appearance. So I don't know. In the olden days, they would totally segregate people in junior high, and boys would go to shop, girls would go to home ec. I mean, how's that? So you guys would learn to cook, and we'd learn how to hammer and, you know, do manly stuff. And so one of the things we did is we worked with sheet metal. So if you take a thin piece of sheet metal and a ball peen hammer. Now, how do I know this? Because junior high boys, I don't know how people ever teach them, they do stuff like that. So if you take a round hammer and hammer the heck out of a thin piece of sheet metal, you get this appearance, and so they'll often call it a beaten metal appearance. And so these are guttata, and what do guttata characterize by pathologically? So there's the guttata. What the heck is this right here?
Oh, so that's where decimase would be.
All right, so that is decimase. What's different about that?
It's just super thick.
Yeah, so decimase membrane will become diffusely thickened. And then because this is an endothelial dystrophy, as the endothelial cells are affected, they start to lay down extra material, which then gathers in clumps, these so-called guttata. And then unfortunately, the endothelial cells die off. So the end result is you get corneal edema. But here, decimase is markedly thickened, Here's the Boutade, and if you see them, they're flat top. They look like buttes. So for those of you not from the West, buttes are those things you see when you drive across Wyoming. Flat top, steep sides, that's what these Guttata look like. So Fuchs endothelial dystrophy. What do you see in here? Oh, pushing.
Yeah, so I know like for boards they talk a lot about like the peripheral, like Hassel-Henley Guttata that are asymptomatic. What's like the actual difference? Like,
you know, pathologically they look exactly the same.
Why don't we still get like endothelial?
Because they're only at the far periphery. So they're what we call a watershed effect. And so anywhere in the eye where you are kind of at the end of nutrients, you can get breakdown as you get older. And so if you think of it, you know, the nutrition in the anterior chamber, it comes from the ciliary body through the pupil up into the anterior chamber. And eventually, by the time you get to the cells right by the trabecular meshwork, all the good humors have been sucked out of that. And so over 50, 60, 70 years, those cells start to break down. So you get little guttata right near the limbus, right near the trabecular meshwork, called Hassel-Henley warts. So they're a watershed event. Kind of like at the far peripheral retina, where, you know, the blood supply before you get to the ora serrata, the good humors are all taken out of that. And so in older patients, you'll often get little schisas, little splits, little cysts in the peripheral retina, same idea. So when you look at Hassel-Henley warts, they're exactly the same as guttata. It's just they're an aging effect in a watershed area in the far periphery of the cornea. All right, what are we seeing right here?
This is an external photograph of a patient looking in down gaze, tension drawn to the right eye. You can see there's some indentation of the lid crease because it's on the Munson sign.
This is Munson sign. What is this a sign of?
Keratoconus.
So this has to be pretty severe in order to actually see the cone when you look at it. But this is what they talk about. You'll often hear people talk about Munson's sign. And so this is a sign of severe keratoconus. Of course, now with good topography, we can pick up keratoconus at a much earlier degree of differentiation than this. And so that's severe keratoconus. What is keratoconus characterized by pathologically?
So it's a breakdown in decimase, which is we can see here pathologically.
Breakdown in, I know your brain said it, but your mouth said decimase.
Oh, Bowman's.
Bowman's, see, yeah. And you see up there, you know, you always say what you think, not what you said. So I tell the nurses that too. Give me the instrument I need, not what I asked for. So I knew you meant Bowman's. And so it's a discontinuation of Bowman's here. And so it's thought to even be a Bowman's dystrophy. And so you get these focal breaks, discontinuities. Now, the stroma is thinned in these areas, which is why it pooches out. And you often will get these breaks in Bowman's. All right, Abby, this patient comes in, they're wearing contacts for keratoconus, and they say, wow, my vision suddenly went really blurry.
I was suspecting.
All right. All right, so high drops. So if you get a break in decimase, and the way I think about it is when you have severe keratoconus, it stretches, and finally decimase breaks. And then you get a gush of fluid into the cornea, so you get an acute corneal edema. And here we have, what kind of stain is this? PAS, and so sure enough, here's Bowman's layer that broke, and you can see Bowman's has got some elastic properties to it, so it curls up, and then the fluid gushes into the cornea, so you get corneal edema. So here's a close-up of decimase, and you can see that acute break, and so you get what's called acute high drops, acute corneal edema. Okay, what kind of stain are we doing right here?
Prussian blue,
and what is Prussian blue stain? Iron, how do we remember that? Dr. Patel's not the only one who asks you history questions. Who are the Prussians?
In World War I, they were the German militarists.
Exactly. So they were the German militarists. And so Prussian blue stains iron. And I always equate that to iron. Iron is what tanks are made out of, and bullets and guns and things. So Prussian blue stains iron. This is a Prussian blue stain. So now you guys need to know all of the various iron depositions in the cornea that will stain. But this is the staining that you can get. And so let's pretend this is the base of a cone. keratoconus patient and this epithelium has iron in there, what is this called? A Fleischer ring, exactly. So there's various different rings that can stain the cornea, but the bottom line is they're all due to iron deposition. All right, we've got a cornea right here. It's got a bunch of sutures on it, and we've cut it in half before we process, and it's totally white. What would you be concerned about here? What makes a cornea turn totally white diffusely?
Corneal edema.
Corneal edema, exactly. So when we look right here, what do we see in here?
It's like the epithelium has separated from bones.
All right, so you can see what we call a bolli, which is a nice way of saying just a blister. So there's endothelial damage for whatever reason, and then the fluid will start percolating through. It will gather in these epithelial cells on the base. The cells will eventually pop and they'll form a bolli. Look right here, this is actually epithelial basement membrane, which is different than Bowman's. And so technically these bolli don't dig underneath the epithelial basement membrane. They're in the basilar layer of the epithelium, which then pops. So you leave the basement membrane still on Bowman's layer, but then the epithelial layers pop and you eventually get this bolli. And so bullous keratopathy, a sign of diffuse damage to the endothelium. And then we say goodbye to the dome on the duomo. Florence, questions in 2 minutes. Yes.
I was on a transfer center call and the emergency department physician used the term Wesley immune ring. You ever heard that term?
Wesley's immune ring is literally just a deposition of we think it's immune cells that make it turn white. But I don't know. We really don't ever use that term, so I'm not sure what that means. It's a ring. It's a ring infiltration due to infiltration of white blood cells, usually mononuclear cells in the cornea, but we usually don't use that term much. When you get a call from the ER and they tell you something, just go look at it yourself, please. You don't know what they're seeing, so just go look at it yourself. Other questions?
Do we still do like anterior stromal puncturing from all these like EBMD and recurrent erosions, or is that like prehistoric?
Well, no, but it is a way to get it to stick down. And so if they're getting recurrent erosions from, let's say, a map dot fingerprint or something similar, you want to help it scar down a little bit. And the way we used to do it is micropuncture in Bowman's layer, and that'll actually diffusely get it to stick better. Nowadays, we will often remove the epithelium completely, put a bandage contact lens on, and let it regrow from the limbus out. Or you can even use an eczema laser to remove all that abnormal basement membrane and kind of caramelize what's left of Bowman's layer there and hopefully allow it to smoothly come over and do it. But if you have recurrent erosions and you've tried everything and nothing has worked, micropuncture, you just take a bent 25 gauge needle. It almost looks like a little cystotome that you use to make an anterior capsulotomy in cataract surgery. You make a bunch of micropunctures and that will again get it to stick down better.